morning, everyone.
Happy Sunday. It's so great to have you join us with Breakfast with the Host. Beth.
I'm Levy.
And Lev, why don't you introduce yourself? Because you've only hosted once before, haven't you? And for some reason, they didn't ask you to come back, so...
I've preached more times than I hosted.
Well...
But anyway, introduce myself. So I'm Levy. I'm from Brazil. So the accent's a little bit different. Don't know, I'm an intern here in Riverside. I do graphics for Riverside, the videos they watch, things like that. And that's it, there isn't much.
What is your favorite Portuguese word? Just as a fun fact by yourself.
My favorite Portuguese word?
Yeah, your favorite Portuguese word, the one that sounds the funniest when you say it.
Borboleta.
Borboleta.
It's butterfly. I don't know why this came into my head.
Big fan of butterflies, yeah. They're my favorite animal.
What is your favorite Portuguese word?
I don't know any Portuguese words.
What is one that you know?
Fala, which means to speak.
Pretty good.
Fluent.
Almost fluent.
Fluent. This time next week, yeah, I'll be fluent in Portuguese. So right. So, you've got awarded with us today, the Dream Team, this morning. So we thought we'd just... I want to talk to you about our weeks, really. It's been an interesting week, hasn't it?
Yeah, so this week was Rachel's birthday.
It was 25 again.
No, it was great, and we decided to bake her a cake, right?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Cupcakes. We did butterfly cupcakes. First time that I did that.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. Do you know, butterfly again, random. Do you know what butterfly cupcakes are? Because I was like telling Lev, and he was like, no idea. You know, when you like scoop the top bit out, put jam and cream in, and then cut the wings and put them in. Because ours looked not like butterflies, did they? Really?
That's the thing. It sounds amazing. And the way that I pictured would be like a butterfly. And we're like... I'll tell, that's a butterfly, but it didn't look like a butterfly.
Wait, I'm not Picasso though, am I? I did the best of what I could.
It did taste really good. It did taste really good.
I think really is quite like a...
Okay, no, it tasted good. It
tasted edible.
Until Liz Allen.
Oh, yeah.
She baked Rage, some cake, some...
Two cake, lemon cake and Rocky Road cake, which was amazing. Yeah. I meant that our cakes...
It wasn't that...
It wasn't
awesome.
They weren't
after
that good,
the cake,
were they?
After Liz Allen cake, our cake was.
I think anyway, like Rocky Road and cakes with raisins in, which is another cupcake that we made. I think like they don't really compare because Rocky Road is obviously going to be better, isn't it?
Yeah, please let us know what is your favorite cake in the comments.
Yeah. Also, with Mum's birthday, I think you'd be aware that she's taken up the couch to 5K. Thing and we were like, I was like, what do you want for your birthday? She's like, oh, maybe some running trainers, just some running attire. That's what we buy her. Everything is running based.
And then
all of a sudden, like 2 nights before her birthday, she's talking to Dad and she's like, yeah, I think I might give up running. Well, it's too late now. You're gonna have to commit because you've got the same amount of trainers as you.
She doesn't have a choice anymore.
She doesn't have
Is that an incentive? Is it an incentive?
It's an incentive, yeah, to wear the new shoes.
But yeah.
And the new trousers. I did think as well, which is not the right way to think, but I was like, well, if she doesn't use them, me and Mum are like the same size, so I was like, if all else fails, I've just got loads of new running clothes. Not that I go out very often, that makes it sound like I'm running every
day.
Yeah,
yeah. She doesn't. To be honest, you haven't been.
All right,
you haven't been running.
No, yeah, you don't.
You haven't been running only because of your mom, right? You can't. You help her to go for a run.
Yeah, to keep going. Yeah, to go. What was this? To go for a run.
Like that's how I imagine them running. I don't know.
Well, I sprint. I don't sprint. We were looking at the because we there's this like running app that tracks how fast you run, and I thought I was in like quite a good pace, or like 6 something. And then I look at Levs and it's like 4, and I was like, right, well, you know what? It's not fun. It's like Levs is like run 12k at this pace, and I run 1k. That's like 6, and I'm like, oh my word, that was really impressive.
You're getting there.
Well, that's what you say when like kids are rubbish at sports, isn't it? Like, if you're taking part that counts, you're getting there. 10 out of 10. But
okay, so moving on from Rachel's birthday, let's talk about improving skills.
No, I don't come out well in this topic though. So this week, Chloe came home with some bubble gum.
Yeah.
That a colleague had kindly gifted her, and we found out that both me and Josh have never learnt how to blow bubbles in bubblegum. And I don't think that's uncommon. Like, I think that, like, that's a pointless skill to have. And who learns that?
Everyone.
No, no. Who? You don't have a lesson in school being like, right, firstly you just stretch it over your tongue and then blow
a bubble. I think you should.
Why? What? At what point? No one in a job interview is going to be like, yeah, I can blow bubbles and
like
bubblegum.
Every kid in school knows how to do that.
No, they don't. I didn't.
At least in Brazil, they do. Like, every kid in school, you have the weird ones that
don't. Right, yeah, you have the weirdos.
There's an archer bubble.
The ones like you. So just everyone in Brazil, is it like a requirement in terms, and in order to be a citizen in Brazil, you have to be able to blow a bubble?
Yeah.
No, yeah.
Okay, bubble guns. What else are you improving in your skill set?
I think I've got lots of talents, which is why I don't come out well in this, because none of these are talents. Cycling. Let's talk about cycling. I went on a cycle ride last week.
Yeah, so basically, we went on a cycle ride. Was nice, was good, but it was the first time that I saw she cycling. And she was kind of like, she was okay, but she's quite like a tense cyclist. She's like,
oh my goodness, guys.
Are you okay, Beth?
I can't really cycle in a straight line either. So whenever there's someone in the path, it's a bit like, oh my word, I can't do it. And I tried to get back onto a bike and cycled into a fence.
Yes, like, she did.
Straight into the fence. But
I was quite worried once we had to cross some lights, you know. The first time that she had to use the brakes, and I was like, does she know how to use the brakes?
What? Who doesn't know how to use the brakes?
I don't know.
I thought I could beat the car across the road. I couldn't. Oh. Also, what was funny is like before, I was like, oh yeah, I'm just going to go for a little cycle just to make sure I can do it before we commit to cycling. And so like before, I was like, oh, I'll just cycle around kind of the estate is in like a circle. So like, but I was going for quite a long time because it's uphill.
Yeah, it took her like, I don't know, 10 minutes to come back.
Like, Lev just stood there like, I thought you'd fallen off somewhere. And I nearly did run a kid over as well. Because they were like walking. And I think they thought that I was going to move out of the way. And I thought that they were going to stop walking. And they didn't. And I'm quite like a drastic swerver as well. And then I panic.
No, honestly, you did better than I expected.
Right, well, what did you expect? Me to be like lying in a bush on the way back? Being like, right. We can't do it. And when I say we went for a cycle ride as well, it makes it sound like we went far. We cycled maybe about 10 minutes away.
Yeah, I was worried. So I was like, maybe.
It's like a total 20 minutes of cycling.
Yeah. It starts slowly, man. So like running, you start slowly.
Well, it's not starting slow because I'm there. A month from now, you can go. I'm going to wee myself. He's there. No hands. Just like, woohoo.
Oh, yeah. You need.
Swerving. What do you mean? You need to
You
do
need
it.
To get to this point that you can like cycle and just put your hands
on
your pocket.
A bike.
You know?
Put your hands in the pocket.
Yeah.
I mean, I partly was wanting you to fall off in a way that I didn't want you to fall off. But also, we've got Josh and Chloe by the time we're going, 2 minutes left!
Two minutes, everybody! Okay, so, cycling. Why don't you talk to them about your parking skills?
Right. I'm not a good parker or a driver.
No, she is.
Right, I'm a slowly improving parker and driver. And whenever I go to Tesco's, the big Tesco's, you can park on the other side of the car park where no other cars park.
Yeah,
and you don't have to park. You could just drive through two spaces and you're in the space. And so that's usually where I always park.
Yeah, you park basically outside the car park.
Yeah, and it's like a 5 minute walk from there to the doors of Tesco's. Because I'm not worried I'm going to hit another car. But yesterday,
you did really well.
I did park really close. I parked really close to another car.
Oh, but.
But.
What?
But I was on the line, so.
Yeah. You're improving. Like yesterday. Yesterday, when you parked, like.
Oh, when we went for a walk.
Yeah.
I met Joe for a walk.
And I met Emmerich for a walk.
And because obviously you have to go separately. But because we were in one household, we like drove there together. And I was parked maybe about, in the middle of the road, really?
Like, this far from the road, from the curb.
What's even worse is I thought I was a lot closer there. So I pull in and I was like, you're quite far out. I was like, no, I think it'll be all right. And then I turn around and you've got Joe, Paul and Emmerich all looking out the window being like, you're quite far from the curb. It's like, do you know what? just pipe down. I'm plenty close enough. I didn't want to twist my ankle getting out of the car because I was
that
too
is true.
Close.
That is true.
And yeah. That didn't happen, did it? So
things should improve. So maybe next time on the next live stream, you're going to be able
maybe.
To tell something like, oh, I've
improved. Yeah, would appreciate
that.
Prayers. People would appreciate prayers. But anyway, sadly, that's the end of our breakfast. I hope that you feel like you've learned a lot about me. I feel like I've got a lot to improve on in the next couple of weeks. But we're going to go straight to our pre-service opener and we'll see you in a sec. Riverside live stream, everyone. It's so great to have you with us this morning.
Yes, good morning. My name is Levy.
My name is Beth, and this is Riverside Live. I feel like I've said that like four times already, but it's still great to have you here. But yeah, we've got lots of really exciting things coming up today.
A good service today.
So we've got an exciting message from Pastor Aaron today. We've got an incredible worship band ready to go.
Yes.
We've got communion today.
Communion.
So
get your bread,
get your red juice ready. Get your hearts ready. Amen. And yeah, we're excited. Excited to see what God's going to do.
If you can, please share on your live stream on your social media and get your friends to like, and maybe someone will see what you're doing here and maybe even like get saved today, you know, could be an amazing thing to happen. But yeah.
Get sharing, get commenting as well. Just give our media team something to do, you know. Say hi to them. Give them some love.
The PACE team is there.
The PACE team, they're ready to respond. They're raring to go. So we're going to go into worship now, but I'm just going to pray first, and then we're going to launch straight in, if that's okay. So, Father God, we thank you that you're so good, and we thank you that even throughout lockdown, we've still been able to meet together online. And, Father God, we just pray that this morning, would you just show up like you always do. Would you prepare our hearts? Would you prepare like our ears and make them ready to listen to what you're going to say this morning? And God, we just pray for fun. We pray for your joy. And we just pray that you will just be fully in it and fully here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks, worship.
Good morning, church. It's great to be with you. Let's just begin to worship together now. Your breath come from heaven, fill welcome you in this place this morning. We just want to bring you here. We want to just announce that we are here for you, God. That there's no other reason we're, you know, on a Sunday morning tuning into a live stream and just watching, you know, a group of people together. What do we share? What's our common interest? God, it's you. You're above all of this. And so, God, we just want to remember this morning that, yeah, we're here to worship God. We're not here to just listen to songs. This isn't just music. This is an offering for you, God. So, yeah, I just, in this next song, I pray that we all just take this chance. Remember, it's not about the music. It's not about what you're listening to. It's not about the enjoyment of the song. It's just about going, God, we want to give you something. We want to bring something to you. We want to share our time, our energy, our voices, communally and together to go, God, you are good. You are above all things. So, yeah. Let's just do that together now. When music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come longing just to bring something that's of love that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You can search much deeper. Something that's a word that will bless your heart. song in itself. It's not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Yes, Jesus, we love you. Yeah. We love you so much, and we want you in this place right now. We want you with us in this morning. And I just want to, would you take us back to the simplicity of worshiping you and loving you this morning, and take us close to your hearts this morning in all that we do.
Yeah.
As we take communion, as we hear from your words, as we worship, just bring us close to you this morning.
Yeah, great.
I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team, for that. That was
really
super
good.
Awesome. I love Heart of Worship. It's one of those classics, isn't it? Every time someone plays it, you're like, yes, amen.
Yeah.
It's one of those timeless classics.
That's really good.
So we still have lots of very exciting things coming up.
Yes.
So we're going to go straight into Riverside News. So get your notepads ready.
Hi, my name's Charlotte,
and I'm
Rebecca, and this is Riverside News.
Hey, feeling good, like I should. Been in circle walk around the neighborhood, feeling blessed.
Welcome to Riverside Church, it's great to have you here. If it's your first time with us this morning, please drop us a message, because we'd love to get connected with you.
Yeah, and you can also follow us on our Facebook and Instagram for more updates.
We have got great news. Following the latest government announcement, we are so excited to tell you today that we will be opening the doors of the church on Palm Sunday. That's the last Sunday of March, and it's a soft launch to get us comfortable back again in the building, ready for the Easter service on that. So it's a soft launch opening on Palm Sunday, and we're looking forward to seeing you all there.
Sadly, this is the end of Riverside News, but Kyle has a joke for us.
What's the best thing about Switzerland?
I don't know
either, but the flag is a big plus.
Hi kids, my name is Janita, and together with the other girls from the PACE team, we've prepared an amazing kids video for you to watch. It will be on the topic of Hezekiah reopening the doors in the Temple of Jerusalem. And we will be doing many fun things. We will be doing worship together, singing and dancing together. We will pray together. We will hear about an amazing story in the Bible together. And we will also do a craft about an open door. And for the craft, you will need paper, some colorful pens, scissors, and glue. If you want to check it out, it will be on a Facebook page at Sunday on 11 a.m. So make sure that you and your parents check it out. I'll see you then. Bye.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So guys, we are so excited that we're going to be back in the building.
On the 28th,
yep.
Palm Sunday at 10:30 a.m. we're going to be back in the building. It's going to be so good to see everyone in the building. So if you want to come in, you need to send us a message or Josh.
Right, studio team, if you could pipe down, that'd be great. Thank you.
On Church Suite. Book in. But it's going to be great.
We're going to be really excited. Like, I think like Pastor Aaron said in the video, it's going to be like a soft launch. So then we're going to be like working it out. But we are really excited that we're going to be able to meet back together as family.
It's going to be so good.
As family. So it's been nearly 3 months since you've seen our faces in person.
True.
So
it
may be a blessing for you, but not long left until you get to see us. But we're really excited for that. And also, how awesome was news this week as well?
Oh, yes. Kyle, Charlotte, and Rebecca, you guys did amazing.
They fully committed, didn't they? On the Easter egg hunt. I'm absolutely hyped about the Easter egg
trail.
Easter egg
trail on the 3rd of April, at Saturday, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. So if you got kids...
A 3-hour Easter egg trail. Can you do it as an adult?
I think you can. I think you're allowed.
I'll be there.
Put in your calendar. It's going to be really fun. More about that is going to come up as well. They did so good.
And the joke. Do you know what? That joke is actually one that Chloe tried to tell ages ago on a live stream and completely just missed it. And she's like, do you know what the good thing about Switzerland is? And then she just was like, she just completely forgot it. She was like, right, moving on there. And it just like went down like a lead balloon. So guys... You delivered. Finally, made it through onto a live stream. And also, really excitingly, today, after the service, we have our youth Zoom call.
That's
so
quite nice.
If you are between the ages of 11 and 18, we have a Zoom games call after the service. It starts at 12 o'clock, so please drop us a message if you want to come to that, because it'd be great to have you. We're going to have some fun.
We're going
to play
fun.
Some games. It's all going to be on Zoom. And we'd love to send the link through to you. So hopefully we'll see you there.
Great. So now we're going to go for a Star of Hope. So I'm looking forward for that. It's a really good one.
Awesome.
Take it away, Jenny.
Well, who would have thought of an evacuation in peacetime? But that's what happened to me this weekend. I live 163 metres from the bomb. And we had a late night call to say we had to leave, and sure enough, a knock on the door early the following morning telling us it's time to go. It was hard. I'm a widow without family, so to see my neighbours getting into cars and going... Who would have thought of an evacuation in peacetime? But that's what happened to me this weekend. I live 163 metres from the bomb. And we had a late night call to say we had to leave. And sure enough, a knock on the door early the following morning telling us it's time to go. It was hard. I'm a widow without family. So to see my neighbours getting into cars and going off as family units, whereas I was a solitary person walking along a deserted road with a little bag. Nobody could come in to get us because of the cordon. But I knew where I was going, because thanks to Pat Cave, she provided a home for me. So off I went. When we knew we could come home a few days later, we didn't know what we were going to come home to find. We'd heard of so much damage. But when I got home, it was fine. The house next to me and opposite me and the other side of me all had damage to their roofs. My house and the one diagonally opposite, where my godchildren live, no damage whatsoever. They said to me, "You prayed, didn't you?" We now talk about our angelic protection squad looking after us. But that's because I knew where I was going. I knew that the Lord had said he sets us solitary in families, that he would never leave us nor forsake us. He kept us all safe. He protected us. He made provision for us. I just say thank you, Jesus, for what you have done. You've given me a testimony of your goodness and your glory, and that people are saying prayer works. Believe me, it really does.
Awesome, awesome. Thanks, Jenny. We thought that the first bit was so good that you wanted to see it twice.
See it twice.
And what was so funny is we had no idea. We're just like opening the little communion pots and like close up. Oh no!
We're on camera.
Oh no! We're just like there on camera. But it was an awesome story. And I love how God is a God who provides. And
true.
And Jenny, thank you for sending this story. And it's so relevant. And if you were impacted by the Exeter bomb and there's anything that you need us to do that we can help either in prayer or you just need someone to talk to you about it or you're not at your home at the moment, you haven't been able to go back and you need some support, please just let us know because we'd love
please.
To get alongside you and walk with it through you and we are praying for you. So yeah.
We are. And if you have stories of hope, please always send us new stories of hope because you're always looking forward for like testimonies like that, you know, things that really encourages us. But now we're going to move out to a time of communion. If you've got something that you can have communion with, bread, some red juice, or anything that's going to represent and communion, please get communion ready.
Yeah.
I'm going to read a passage, and after that we're going to have communion together.
Mm.
So I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 11, 23. It's okay. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So now if you want to take the bread, I'm going to pray before we eat. Jesus, we thank you for your body that was broken so we could have life.
Yes.
And we pray that as we eat of this bread, we pray that you may touch our body, our physical body, you may touch our emotions, everything. And we believe it, but that by your stripes you are healed. So if anyone needs a healing in this morning, as they eat from their body, we pray for a healing over their bodies. In Jesus' name. You can have your bread now. So, in the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me, as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again." So Jesus, we took this cup and we thank you because we are saved by your blood.
Yeah.
And your blood makes us one. You can take the cup now. Now we're going to go for a time of worship and you can reflect on this time and just remember how much God loves you, you know, and how his sacrifice transforms our lives.
Yeah, great. Thanks
for worship.
Take me back to where we started. I
you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up. Caught up in this holy moment, I never want to leave. I'm not here for blessings, and Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you, and I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I God, that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Oh, I just want nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, and no one else, nothing else will do. I just want you, oh Jesus. You're the King of the world, you're worthy of it all. And I just want you. I don't want another song, I don't want to feel like anything. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want.
Hey church, great to see you today. Hopefully you are really excited about the news that we will be opening the doors of our church services for you to come and attend live and in person. And we're really excited about that, number one, because we can bring the family together. We can bring that contact where we can just have human contact and relationships again. We're still under a couple of restrictions for that, but we're really excited to, on Sunday the 27th of March is our return, and that will just get us ready for Easter Sunday. This is such an exciting time. I want to talk today about opening the doors of the church, because it's just relevant to where we are at the moment, but I also want to talk through what the scripture says, and the Bible talks about open doors. There's a great scripture in 2 Chronicles chapter 29 that talks about King Hezekiah. And so I'm just going to look in the first three verses. If you've got your Bibles, open them to that. And while you're looking in your Bibles, I want to tell you about the books of Kings and Chronicles. Essentially, this talks into the nation of Israel during a very troublesome time for them. It tracks the leadership, the kings of the nations. Now, the nation of Israel was split at that time from the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. And it follows the kings of all of those. In fact, there's 20 kings per each part of that. And the northern kingdom, they had 20 kings who just led the people away from God. Effectively, they were bad kings in relation to spiritual leadership. And the southern kingdom did slightly better. There was 8 of the 20 kings that they had that led people back to God. And just for simple illustrations, we understand the concept of fish swimming downstream, and everybody, all the kings, all the spiritual leaders at that time are swimming downstream. But the book is actually about the kings that decided to go against the flow and swim upstream. You may have seen salmon returning to their place of their birth to actually kind of reproduce, and you'll see flashes of salmon jumping out of that, going against the flow. And the 8 kings of Judah were about that. Hezekiah is one of those flashes of silver salmon coming up to leaders that we as people can go against the flow. Let's read what it says about King Hezekiah. It says, in the first month of the first year of his reign, Hezekiah reopened the doors of the temple and of the Lord and repaired them. He was 25 years old when he came into his role as a king. His dad was not a great king in issues of spiritual leadership. The nation was controlled by 2 superpowers, either side of the nation of Israel. That's Egypt on the left-hand side and Assyria on the right-hand side. 700 years before the birth of Jesus, and Assyria was controlling the nation of Judah, where Hezekiah was there. His dad had bowed as a puppet king to the Assyrians, and he'd torn up the church, the temple. He'd stopped all of what was required to do to observe the worship of the one true God, and they had nailed the doors of the church shut and blocked people getting in to the presence of God. Now, the relevance of that for us today is, if you'd have said 12 months ago and come up to me and said, Aaron, I feel God is saying that over the next 12 months, the doors of the church are going to be shut, I would have gone, no way is that going to happen. And that did happen. This is where we are, that somehow the doors of our building have been closed. And actually, this scripture speaks to me that God has got this plan to open the doors, and he's looking for a generation of people who are going to go against the flow of what everybody else is doing and open the doors of the plans and purposes of God into this community, into this generation, into this season of our life. And this message is going to steer us and direct us towards that point. Now, open the doors are mentioned quite frequently in the Bible. And just as a basis of understanding, I want you to just grasp what open doors are really all about. Number one, when you see the phrase open doors in the Bible, it is talking about a season of opportunity. And so as we are moving into a new season as a church, as we are moving into a new season as a region and as a country, as spring starts to come, I want you to understand this is a season of opportunity. This is not a season of restriction. This is a season of opportunity where we should be starting to get excited and saying, God, what are you asking us, your church, your people, to do during this phase?
The second thing, it is a threshold and a transition point. When the mention in the Bible of doors is mentioned, we are standing on the threshold of something. It's like a doorway that we're going to walk into for the next phase of our life. Where we are now and what we're about to walk into. And this talks about change for us. I know a lot of us don't want change, don't like change, not comfortable where we are. But when God is doing a new thing, when God is opening doors ahead of us, he's starting us to show, I'm going to move you from this place to the next. And boy, do we need change. Boy, do we need transformation, not just of our heart or our confidence, but our dreams and our visions. And as we open up, we're moving into something brand new of that. And finally, Open Doors talks about borders of breakthrough. I don't know if you've ever been on holiday, you know, and if you've moved from one country to another, there's a borderline between those countries. And you'll see it normally observed by a checkpoint by which you have to take your passport and give you permission to enter. The laws are different. You know, you can work from one place, you can have own property in one country, you go to another country and you don't, vice versa. The laws are different. You could be a criminal on the run and you can move from one place as a criminal and move into a new place. Citizenship is different. Everything is different when you cross the border into a new country. And I want you just to understand that God wants us as a church to cross the border from lockdown into freedom. From being held back into an opportunity as a new season that we're going to push into something brand new. And I think God is going to give spiritual passports out to you this morning. I think he's going to give you a new confidence. I think he's going to give you a fresh wave of a move of the Holy Spirit to say, come on, let's get going. Spring's going to sprung on your life. You're going to jump out and bud out in the new things of God. There is a new day coming and God is drawing things and opening doors, not just for the church, but for you as an individual, for you as a family, to come out of this stronger than when you went in, because God has been doing an incredible work. When it comes to open doors, in simple, they are either open or they're shut. It's either an entrance or an exit, or it's locked or unlocked. And I just want to talk about that just briefly, if I can, because I want God to show you what's in the next room of your life, prophetically, to speak into you right now, to give you an inclination of what he is opening. You know, because that door, when we look, it's suddenly we're looking at our lives and going, I wonder if there's something new. I wonder if God is moving me. And the message of the open doors reignites a passion for embracing new opportunities. Now, doors are entrances and exits. And let me tell you, you need to exit some rooms in your life that you've found yourself in the last 12 months. If you're in a room of negativity, if you're in a room of depression, if you're in a room of darkness or bitterness or hurt or pain, God actually says, I don't want you to hold in that room in this coming phase. I have opened a door that no man can shut. And I want you to lead out of that dark room into this new place of light, and I have opened a door. And so we exit some things and we enter something new. Let me tell you, God always takes us through these breakthrough moments to bring us out into new places. There's a story in the New Testament of Paul and Silas who were locked up in prison. And in prison as prisoners, they said, we're not going to be confined by the chains or by the bars in the window or by the walls, but we are going to praise God and we're going to worship. You know what? Their praise and worship was so powerful that the presence of God shook the walls of that prison and broke open the doors, and freedom followed, because that is the plan. God doesn't want you to live in chains or held back. He wants to set you free because he wants to open the doors, you know, and that we need to unlock those doors that are holding us back in the next 12 months. The Bible says in Matthew 18, verse 18, truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Did you know, as a follower of Jesus, you have authority to open doors in your life? As Rachel spoke last week, it's about hurts, hang-ups, you know, we have the power to get beyond those and speak to those situations and to lead us from those places into a new place of light, to walk through the door to be free. You know what, as parents, we have the ability to set new environments of our children. You know, we give permission to our children all the time. How I am with my kids, what they see me doing, you know, if it's okay for me, it's okay for them. And that relates to more what I, how I speak. You know, I could have a negative tongue. And if I do that, they go, that's just normal. You know, and we see that in generations kind of passing on from culture to culture, certain ideals, certain strongholds, even abusive families pass on one to another because they are given permissions. Let me tell you right now that what you do, how you live, how you speak gives permission to the next generation to follow suit. But what if we gave a new position to release a heavenly language? What if we released a heavenly attitude? What if we released a new culture of the Spirit of God and we live that and everybody else coming behind us watching us and going, that's how I want to live my life. This message is an invitation to move into the open plans and purposes of God, that we do this together. Now, as I said, Bible talks about open doors regularly throughout Scripture. And I just want to talk a few of those instances we find. And if you have your Bibles, turn to 1 Samuel 3, verse 15. And this is a door of relationship. I believe that God wants to lead us in the next phase of the door into a relationship with the living God. Samuel was a child and God wanted to speak to him and called out to him in the night. You know, and Samuel walks through this process of identifying and recognizing the voice of God by seeking help from the priest at the time, saying, did you call me? And he said, no, I didn't call you. And he goes back and repeats it. And then finally the priest gets in and says, God is calling you, Samuel. And during the night, Samuel has this revelation from God. This relationship is established with the one true God. And it says in 1 Samuel 3 verse 15, Samuel stayed in bed until morning. He got up and he opened the doors of the tabernacle as usual. He was afraid to tell Eli what the Lord had told him. And in this moment, I'm just going to prophesy over your life. This season is going to be a time of relationship with God. God is calling you into his presence. God is calling you to talk to you. God is showing you what's going on in the next room. God is preparing you, you know. And the key to that door of the secret place of relationship is intimacy with him, and he's inviting you to cross the threshold from a low casual relationship with God into a new, vibrant, dynamic, electric relationship with him. And it's an open door. Do you want to walk through that? The second open door I read about is in Kings again, 2 Kings chapter 9 verse 1, the story of Elisha the prophet. Let me read this to you. It said, Elisha the prophet had summoned a member of the group of prophets. He was mentoring a group of prophets. He said, get ready to go to Ramoth Gilead. He said, take this olive oil with you. And that's how they anointed new kings. He says, and go and find Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, and the grandson of Nimshi. Call him into a back room away from his friends. And pour the oil on his head and say to him, this is what the Lord says. I anoint you to be a king over Israel. Then open the door and run for your life. I love this passage because this tells me about an open door of revelation of the prophetic word of God. We are moving into a new season. You are moving into a new season where God is going to speak to you about what is to come. There's going to be revelation that comes out of your relationship. You know, and that oil, you know, that anointing oil was a sign of the presence of God. And as you pour it on this new king, run and open the door. Let me tell you, the prophetic word of God opens doors into your life. It brings breakthrough. You read the story in 2 Kings chapter 9. As they ran through the door, it says the door swung open and then slammed shut. And everybody goes, oh my goodness, what happened? Because the word of the Lord, when we act on God and we are obedient to what God says, people start to notice a new generation. There's a new shift of leadership. There's a new spiritual direction that comes aloud because people who are anticipating God about to speak. The key to the door of prophetic revelation is anticipation. That we sit here and go, God, you are doing something new. So what is it? You are opening a new door. So what is the new door? Where am I now? And where are you walking me into? Where are we going as a church? And God is revealing that to us as we make this journey. And a third door I see. You can find it in the book of Psalm chapter 78 verse 23. It says, God commanded the skies to open. He opened the doors of heaven and rained down manna for them to eat. He gave them bread from heaven and they ate the food of angels. This talks about the time when the children of Israel were walking from captivity into the promised land, and there in the transition point on the threshold of breakthrough, God provides heavenly manna for his people. This is a season of the provision of God, and I can testify to you from the vision report that you've all been reading for the last few weeks how wonderfully God has provided for us during this season. And it's just a transition point as we come to the next stage and the next one. He opened the windows of heaven. Did you know in Malachi it says about if we give to God, if we tithe and regularly invest into the plans of God, he will open the windows of heaven of blessing on us. And let me tell you, for those who've invested over this season in church, thank you very much. But I know this, that God is going to shower you with blessing, and a reward is coming into your life because you've been faithful to take what you have to invest. And that's incredible, because God reveals his resources into our life. And as much as there are so many open doors in heaven, I wanted to finish and land on a scripture that just so it opens the doors in my thinking, in my belief, in the possibilities of what God is going to do. And you can find it in Mark chapter 1 verse 9. It talks about Jesus' baptism. And this is the open door of heaven. It says, one day, while Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee, as he was baptized by John in the Jordan River, and when Jesus came out of the water, he saw the heavens split open, and the Holy Spirit descending on like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven saying, this is, you are my beloved son, and I am fully pleased with you. When Jesus was baptized, there was an open heaven declared from that moment. There was a season of supernatural, miraculous breakthrough. It was the start of Jesus's ministry. And if you go and study that, he opened deaf ears. He opened blind eyes. He opened the graves. He opened people's minds. He opened people's hearts to the spiritual truth and the plans and purpose of God. There was a breakthrough, an opening of the supernatural. And I want us to dream, that wonder what that looks like if we are living in an open heaven of church in this new season in our life, that there is a direct link between the presence of God and where we are. Bill Johnson, he said, an open heaven is where there's a nearness of heaven to on earth. Now, I have a watch that I charge every night, and it powers me enough to tell me the time and the season that I'm in. And if I don't charge it, the battery goes flat and I can't tell the season. This morning, as I came into church, I looked at my watch and it said, did you want to go into power saving mode? Because I hadn't charged it last night and I was on low power. But there's something great, by the way, because I have a phone. And I can take my phone and I can press a button, and my phone has the ability to power share with my watch. And so I just connected them together, you know, and instantly the power that is in my watch is transferred to my watch. And there you see, it is now able to tell the time. When Jesus was baptized and an open heaven was declared over him, you know what Jesus did? He power shared. Because he came to us as sinners, as created beings, that we were in power saving mode. We were in a low place. We weren't living out how we were designed to be, because we had lived and walked away from God. But God says, I'm not going to leave the children who I love, the family who I love, the people who I designed to live to God. I'm going to go and rescue them. You know, and he came down and he lived his life as an open heaven, and he died on the cross. And the resurrection opened the door for us to power share. And when he rose again, he departed the Holy Spirit. And there was a power transfer that happened in the life of the church. When you see Stephen, who was a follower of Jesus Christ, who was martyred for his faith, what did he see? Just before he entered eternity, he saw a revelation of Jesus sat on the right hand of the Father under an open heaven. And there was an open season on the church for the miraculous, for eyes to be opened, for ears to be unstopped, for the dead to rise, for spiritual new life. And there was a revival that started to sweep all over the church. because Jesus was power sharing an open heaven to us. This is our time, guys. We are a New Testament. We are Holy Spirit, full of God's presence in the church. And I'm really excited that as we are a community, God is opening up us as a community so that we're going to see growth in this next calendar year. God is going to open up the presence of His Holy Spirit. And God is going to open a door of an opportunity for the mission of Jesus Christ. When the Apostle Paul writes about open doors, he is only talking not about a personal open door. He's not talking about himself. I'm going to have great things to do. I've got a new job or this happening family. He's talking about the gospel of Jesus Christ. A wide open door of opportunity for this great news of Jesus to be spread all over that. And we saw this incredible splatter of the church as it expanded during that season because of the influence of the Holy Spirit. And so as we come right now, I want us to take a moment just to reflect that God wants to open the doors of our relationship with Him. He wants to open the doors of revelation of what He wants to say to the church. He wants to open the doors of resources so that we might be blessed and equipped to do everything that He's called us to do. And He wants to open the doors of the church to live in revival under an open heaven. I want to leave you with this final scripture in Revelation 3 verse 20. It says, "Look, I stand at the door and I knock. If you hear me calling, if you open the door, I will come in and I will share a meal with you as friends." I don't know what your response is to this message. I don't know if you're watching this as somebody who's just making their journey into faith, into Christianity. This is Jesus speaking to you saying, "Let me in. I will transform your life. I will fill you with the purpose that you've called to be." And this will be a brand new season, open door. If you've been a Christian for many years, you know what Jesus says? "I want to put you in, not in power sharing mode, but in power receiving mode. Open the door. I'm going to fill you with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to re-energize you to live the way that I designed you to be." Wherever you are right now, as we're going to go into worship, I want you to open the door to the presence of God. And as you do that, I'm just going to pray. Holy Spirit, fill the rooms where we sit right now. Open the door of an open heaven. Let us see an outbreak of a relationship with God, a revelation with God. The heavenly resources to be filled in our room right now, Lord God. And let us see revival of the church as you open doors to an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Do it, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Who could imagine?
Such a good message, isn't it, from Pastor Aaron? And sadly, really, guys, that is the end of all we've got today. But we just want to encourage you to go out, to live with open hearts, and to look for the open doors.
Yes, like, come on.
We believe God is a God of open doors. And before the church doors are open, let's pray that we walk through the doors that He wants us to walk through. And let's look for them, you know. Let's not just wait, but let's pursue them and see what God opens and what
come
He's
on,
doing.
That's great. So yeah, that's it for today.
Yeah, we hope you have a wonderful week. Yes. We hope you've had fun this morning. We've had fun this morning.
We had fun this morning. Enjoy the sun. I think sun. I don't know.
Hopefully enjoy the sunshine, and we'll see you next week, guys.
See you later. Next week. Bye.
Bye.